Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
As you can see, Joanne's not here, she's on holiday. Welcome and an invite for everybody to come through for their tea after the morning worship. The fair is on the 8th of June, 11 till 2 o'clock. If you can help, speak to Margaret Wilson or Lynn Hamilton. And then they've got baking, that they can do baking. Give their names to Margaret as well. There will be a camp session meeting on Tuesday the 28th of May at 7 p.m. and these are all the intimations.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to our service of worship this morning. Took me by surprise. Never can be expected shorter intimations. Maybe it's just I'm used to Joanne Waffler. But it's okay, she's not watching, she's enjoying herself in the sunshine. I have a couple of intimations myself this morning. The first is an edict that I have to read out. This is not a presbytery one, that will become clear. Rachel Boyle, a member of this congregation, has been elected to be a ruling elder, and the camp session has judged her to be qualified for that office and has sustained her election. Rachel Boyle has accepted of the office as elder. If anyone has any objections why any of this member should not be ordained to office, they should state their objection at the meeting of the camp session in the lounge on the 2nd of June at 11 a.m. If no relevant objection regarding life or doctrine is made and substantiated, the camp session will proceed to the ordination. This is by order of the camp session and it's on behalf of Joanne Kennedy, session clerk. So I will read that next week as well. And then on the 2nd of June, if there are no objections, we will have a service of ordination for Rachel to become our newest elder and probably the youngest as well. Yeah, she'll be the youngest. The other thing, just to let people know, is this morning I'm not doing the children's all-age talk this morning. We have four people who at the moment are training for the Word and Worship courses that should hopefully give South and Quarter 6 trained people who can do services as well as myself. And there are parts, there's elements of the services that some of the folks haven't tried before. So just to give a wee bit of experience and a bit of encouragement, I've offered that they can do the parts of the service that they've never done before, before they have to do the really easy bit of a whole service. It's an absolute toddle, don't worry about it. So Alison Gray, this morning, she's one of the people who is training. She is going to do our children's all age talk this morning. So just in case anybody thinks that I'm wanting to take it easy and palm stuff off, I'm not. And I'm hoping that maybe next week James will agree to take it. He's not here this week, so I'll just tell him that he's doing it. That's always the best way, isn't it? Surprising. So he can perhaps take it next week. So please welcome Alison with your usual enthusiasm, since it is Pentecost and it is a celebration of sorts today. So with those thoughts, we will still our hearts and our minds before our call to worship. Jesus promised, "I will ask the Father. He will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. The world cannot accept as they do not see or know him, but you know him. He lives with you and within you." Jesus said, "I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you." As I said, today is Pentecost. So let's open our worship this morning by singing hymn number 197 as we are gathered, and we'll sing it through twice.
And minds by your Holy Spirit. Give us your vision to share and to serve you. Help us to be beacons of hope in today's world. Give us reminders of others we've known who've worked for you and all they did. On this Pentecost Sunday, we pray we can have clarity of vision and a calmness to work together for you. The Holy Spirit is a gift to all who believe. May that same Spirit give us a boldness that transforms our lives and the lives of others. Let your Spirit of truth abide in us so that we may live in hope and grow in faith and keep your commandments of love. In Jesus' name, we offer this prayer and we'll now share the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
The readings today, the first reading is Acts 2, verses 1 to 21, entitled The Holy Spirit Comes at Pentecost. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now, there was staying in Jerusalem at that time God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment, because each one heard them speaking in his own language. Utterly amazed, they asked, are not all these men who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our own nation language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, resident of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs. We hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues. Amazed and perplexed, they ask one another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said, "They've had too much wine." Peter addresses the crowd. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. "Fellow Jews, and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These men are not drunk, as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servant, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days. And they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heaven above and signs on earth below. Blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord, and everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." Our next reading is John 15, 26 to 27. "When the counselor comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who goes out from the Father, he will testify about me, and you also must testify, for you have been with me from the beginning." And John 15, 46 to 15. "I have told you, so that when the time comes, you will remember. And I warned you, I did not tell you this at first, because I was with you. The work of the Holy Spirit. Now I am going to him who sent me. Yet none of you ask me, where are you going? Because I have said these things, you are filled with grief. But I tell you the truth. It is for your own good that I am going away. Unless I go away, the counselor will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. When he comes, he will convict the world of guilt in regard to sin and righteousness and judgment in regard to sin, because men do not believe in me. In regard to righteousness, because I am going to the Father, where you can see me no longer, and in regard to judgment, because the prince of this world now stands condemned. I have much more to say to you, more than you can now hear. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. He will bring glory to me by taking from what is mine and making it known to you. All that belongs to the Father is mine. That is why I said, the Spirit will take from what is mine and make it known to you." May God bless these words from his holy book. Amen.
Thank you, Maureen. Maureen's another one who is considering doing the training And if those two readings and those words in those readings don't get you ready for training, nothing will. So well done. Let's sing together our next hymn, hymn number 189, Be Still for the Presence of the Lord.
So that you can guess what kind of a party it's going to be. Firstly, you can't have a party without some nice food. So, I've brought along some nice cakes.
You want me to hold them up? You get a hand in cake.
Secondly, you don't normally go to a party without bringing something with you.
Right, come on, the two.
I shut you, come up. Oh, there's salmon.
All right, miss. You hold that one. Come on up.
Oh, we need somebody else, so somebody else wants to come up.
You're not getting away with it.
But it's a second. So we have a lovely, beautifully wrapped present. And then we'll ask, you would normally take a card. So lastly, I have a card. You could maybe hold that. You can tell us, Callum, what kind of card it is so that we know what kind of a party it is and hold it up so that many folk can see. It's a birthday card.
Hold them up.
Well done. You hold them up nice and high and then maybe you want to put them down and go back to your seats and have a rest. So, of course, it's a birthday party. So we're going to have a birthday party. So today is the day that we celebrate the birthday of the church. It's the day that the church really got started, and we have a special name for it. Can anyone tell me what it is? It's already been mentioned twice this morning. Anybody here? Well done, Ashley. Pentecost. Excellent. So Pentecost is when we remember the day God sent the Holy Spirit to Jesus' disciples, just as Jesus had promised that he would.
So these things I brought along are going to help us remember what happened at Pentecost and that the Holy Spirit is still at work in the church today. As we heard earlier at Pentecost, tongues of fire came and rested upon each of the disciples when they were filled with the Holy Spirit. The Spirit gave them the ability to speak in other tongues, telling others confidently about Jesus, his teachings, life, death, and resurrection. And it also gives us the power today to tell others about Jesus and to do things that bring glory to God. Among the things that I brought was a present, and the Holy Spirit gave the early church the gifts of forgiveness, truth, and a new life, and offers us the same gifts today. So as we celebrate the birthday of the church today, let's remember that the Holy Spirit is still alive and at work in us today, like he was in the people of the early church. So I think, continuing, we could sing Happy Birthday to the Church, as Stephen would now lead us with Happy Birthday. Finish with a follow-on prayer. Follow me prayer. Sure. Guess what we've got now?
A follow-on
prayer. Well done, Ashley. Can always remember. So let's pray now. Dear Father, we thank you for sending the Holy Spirit.
We thank you for sending the Holy Spirit.
Let us remember that the Holy Spirit still fills the church with power today. Just as he did on the day of Pentecost. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
We'll now continue our worship by singing Mission Praise 613, Spirit of the Living God. And we'll sing it through twice, and it's a short thing.
This morning with a story. I know you all like a wee story. And this one starts in the classic manner. Here we go. Once upon a time, There was a spring of cool, clear, and refreshing water found on an open hilltop. People would come from miles around to drink from the water, and they would go away satisfied. The water was so good that they would tell their friends and neighbours to come and drink. So more and more people came, and soon there was always a crowd around the fountain. Then some people began to complain. Never. They complained that they would get sunstroke waiting on the hot days or soaked on the rainy days. So a canopy was erected over the fountain. But then some people found it inconvenient to bend over to lift up the water to drink. So the fountain spring was encased in stone and drinking taps were provided. More and more people came, and the canopy no longer allowed them all in. So a permanent building was erected with enough room for as many people as would come and a wee bit more besides. Then people began putting pictures on the walls. Others spent much money beautifying the stone building and drinking fountain with gold and with jewels. Then those who had given much started to demand special rights and privileges to the water and decided to charge others to drink from the fountain. Special guardians and keepers of the fountain with special garments and insignia were called to keep the people orderly and obedient. And soon the focus shifted from the water to the gathering place. People began to forget that there was even a fountain at all in all the hustle and the bustle of the assembly. Then the fountain ran dry. We come together because we've been offered living water. Yet often in our church life, it seems we get something else: politics, factions, emphasis in buildings or programs or personal budget, or personnel or budget, maintenance, all a self-centered focus, rather than outreach, caring for those in need, welcoming those without ability to pay. As I'm sure you now know, it's Pentecost, when we remember the outpouring of the Holy Spirit promised by Jesus. John writes, "When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of Truth, who goes out from the Father, he will testify about me. And you also must testify, for you have been with me from the beginning." You see, the Spirit of God bears witness to Jesus. The Spirit is sent to bring all things to remembrance, so that we may remember Jesus, see and know Jesus, and be empowered to witness to Jesus. Our Lord is a living spring of water around which the church is built. We come together to meet Jesus and to receive Jesus. Jesus is the reason we gather. So what happens when Jesus leaves? When the one whom all your hopes were pinned is gone, what then? Ascension was just over a week ago, and Luke's version of that story has the disciples skipping off to Jerusalem with great joy. It's a nice ending to the story that began with angels announcing tidings of great joy to shepherds in a field outside Bethlehem. There's a sort of they lived happily ever after sense that the story has come to a satisfying conclusion, at least for the moment. But you see, we know better. with our 2024 hindsight. We know that those disciples were about to experience hardships and persecution they couldn't possibly have imagined. We know that they would soon fall into disagreement, that they would argue over little things like whose turn it was to wipe down the tables after a meal. And they would argue over the big things, like whether or not a Gentile convert had to become a Jew before they could claim to be Christians. To get through it all, they would need the Holy Spirit to help them, to comfort them, to be Christ's presence among them. In Luke's version, the Holy Spirit comes in a dramatic way in the Jewish festival of Pentecost, 50 days after Passover. And we heard that familiar story from Acts 2 a few moments ago. But today's gospel reading comes from the Gospel of John. And his version of these events takes what you could call a different spin. So to understand Pentecost from John's perspective, we must rewind to the upper room on the night Jesus washed the disciples' feet and shared one last meal with them. We find ourselves in the middle of what scholars call the final discourse. It's the longest speech in all of the Gospels, taking up four full chapters. And we've heard parts of this speech over the past few weeks of the Easter season. And now, as Pentecost brings that season to a close, we come to the final words Jesus gives to his disciples before he prays for them. So, what happens when Jesus leaves? When the one whom all your hopes were pinned is gone? What then? When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who goes out from the Father, he will testify about me. And you also must testify, for you have been with me from the beginning. I have told you this so that when their time comes, you will remember that I warned you about them. I did not tell you this from the beginning because I was with you. But now I am going to him who sent me. None of you ask me, where are you going? Rather, you are filled with grief because I've said these things. But very truly I tell you, it's for your good that I'm going away. Unless I go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. When he comes, he will prove the world to be the wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because people do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father, where you can see me no longer. And about judgment, because the prince of this world now stands condemned. I have much more to say to you, more than you can bear now. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all the truth. He will not speak on his own. He will only speak what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. He will glorify me because it is from me that he will receive what he will make known to you. All that belongs to the Father is mine. That is why I said the Spirit will receive from me what he will make known to you. This isn't a sermon that Jesus has given, or even a teaching moment. Jesus isn't leaving his disciples a carefully constructed list of things to do after he's gone, or one of those step-by-step instruction booklets and how to do them that nobody understands anyway. This final discourse, or as Eugene Peterson calls it, this final conversation, it's more about reminding the disciples of things that they've already heard. Let's be honest, Jesus rambles and repeats himself many times. Over and over he tells his friends that he is leaving. And over he tells his friends that once he is gone, the Advocate will come to be with them. This is an interesting word, Advocate. Only John uses it. Here in the Gospel and once in 1 John. It also gets translated as paraclete, which sounds a lot like the Greek word. It translates parakletos. Now, this isn't the usual word for spirit. Most of the time, the New Testament word for spirit is pneuma, which also means breath or wind. But here John calls the Spirit of Truth the Advocate. This aspect of the Holy Spirit doesn't come as a mighty wind or tongues of fire. You see, the Advocate instead comes alongside, pointing us in the right direction, showing us God's truth, standing with us as we face the world. Now, you need to remember that the world, in John's view, includes everything that is against God. Everyone who doesn't believe in Jesus. And for John, there are only two kinds of people. Those who believe and those who reject. There's no grey area here. No option to accept just the wee nice parts of following Jesus. For John, is all or nothing. You either belong to Christ or you belong to the world. If you belong to Christ, your job is to testify that Jesus is the Son of God. The Advocate standing with you also testifies to this truth. The Advocate will support you in your testimony, helping you to tell your own story of repentance and redemption. But it's your story. You are the only one who can tell it. You are the only one with first-hand knowledge of what God has done in your life through the person of Jesus Christ. While you tell your story, the Advocate will be at work in the hearts and the minds of those who hear you. The Advocate will be agreeing with you and affirming the truth in what you are saying. But Jesus also says the Advocate will also be busy doing some other work too. When the Spirit comes, he will confront the world. As tempting as it may be to explain to non-believers that they are wrong about sin, that they don't understand what it means to be righteous in God's eyes, and they haven't got a clue about judgment, that is not really our job. Our job is to tell our own story of how God loves us, how he has forgiven us, and how he wants us to be part of his kingdom. In fact, in truth, I would think it would probably make the Spirit's job an awful lot easier if we would just get out of the way sometimes. When we start telling others how wrong they are, we aren't doing the Spirit any favours. We only make it harder for those who are in the world to accept the grace of Christ that Christ offers. Because we come across as judgmental and even arrogant. The world sees us as hypocrites who criticise others for the same wrongdoings we commit ourselves. And if through social media or even online. You probably see this all the time in the comments on Facebook or on Twitter, or remarks made in the comments section of articles that get forwarded to you by well-meaning friends. Because there you will see it doesn't take long for disagreement on what is called hot-button topics to lead to those harsh words and very, very cruel language. Instead of escalating conflict with accusations and condemnation, our job is to tell what difference knowing Christ has made in our lives. We are to testify, and that means telling the truth about what we ourselves have experienced in our own walk with Jesus. Then we make it possible for the Spirit of Truth to confront those wrongdoings, to reveal righteousness, and to execute judgment. But that can only happen when the Spirit comes. As Jesus talked at length with his disciples that night, he had to keep repeating these words. I am going away. I have to go away so the Advocate can come to you. Even though you don't want to hear that I'm leaving, it's to your advantage that I go. We all know it's hard to let go of the past in order to embrace the future. The disciples were eager to hold on to what had become familiar to them. They were getting pretty good at this business of following Jesus wherever he went and watching him do amazing things. But Jesus is leaving and the Spirit is coming. Instead of watching Jesus do amazing things, the time has come for the disciples to continue that work. Eugene Peterson writes, "This Holy Spirit will be in them, doing in them what Jesus did among them. The Holy Spirit, God's way of being present with us, will make their life and work continuous with Jesus' life and work. The way God was present to them in Jesus, God will be present to others in them. The leaving and the sending work together. Jesus' absence from them becomes the Spirit's presence in them. Everything Jesus said and did among them is continued in what they say and do. To embrace the unknown future that lies ahead of them, the disciples have to be willing to let Jesus go. But it isn't just those first disciples who must be willing to change. In the story of Pentecost, it's not about what happened way back in that first century Jerusalem. You see, when the Spirit comes, the Spirit keeps coming. Holding on to the familiar and comfortable just isn't possible when the Spirit comes. And that Pentecost day must have been scary, because change can be scary. But it can also be exciting. It will be life-changing. And it also will be Spirit-filled. I'll finish this morning with these thoughts from the poet, songwriter, and now retired pastor, Steve Garness Holmes, who wrote these words. Pentecost was not, as some say, the undoing of Babel. Now we all speak the same language. No, it was the opposite, the blessing of Babel. We learn one another's languages. We embrace diversity and learn to listen to each other, to see from another's perspective, to give voice to a life other than our own, to make central a language that's not our own, to communicate grace that's not on our own terms. We acknowledge the differences in our lives, honour one another's various home places and cultures, and cross over the boundaries of comfort and familiarity. On that Pentecost day, I don't imagine they were very eloquent. They spoke in halting, Phrygian, mangled Mesopotamian. It probably took some back and forth, some double checking. It required not just proclaiming, but listening, relating, and patience on the part of the hearers, and courage and humility on the part of the speakers. Willingness to be beginners, to risk, to appear foolish, to forgo the safety of being in the dominant group. Pray for such humility and courage, to risk for the sake of love, to be foolish for the sake of relating, to let other people's reality be real. In such loving, the Holy Spirit will speak loud and clear. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's sing once again, hymn number 616, There's a Spirit in the Air. To your apostles and disciples. Grant that the same Spirit may perfect in our lives the work of your grace and your love. Christ Jesus, grant us the spirit of fear of the Lord, that we may be filled with a loving reverence toward you. Christ Christ Jesus, grant us the spirit of piety, that we may find peace and fulfillment in the service of God by serving others. Christ Jesus, grant that the spirit of fortitude, grant us the spirit of fortitude, that we may bear our cross with you, and with courage overcome the obstacles that interfere with our salvation. Christ Jesus, grant us the spirit of knowledge, that we may know you and know ourselves and grow in holiness. Christ Jesus, grant us the spirit of understanding, to enlighten our minds with the light of your truth. Christ Jesus, grant us the spirit of counsel, that we may choose the surest way of doing your will, seeking first your kingdom. Christ Jesus, grant us the spirit of wisdom, that we may aspire to the things that last forever. And teach us to be your faithful disciples, and animate us in every way with your spirit. Amen. Amen. Let's sing together our closing hymn, hymn number 600, Spirit of God Unseen as the Wind. And speak of God's goodness in the words of those who would hear. And may the God who breathed life into creation be your delight. May Christ Jesus give hope to your dreaming, and may the Holy Spirit, your advocate and supporter, set your hearts ablaze with a passion for peace. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord in the name of Christ.
Thank you.